the concepts I want to introduce first is animism. What is animism? Animism. What do you understand by animism? Do you hear me? Somebody please answer if you can. If you know, animism.
Is it something related to animals?
Related to animals? Not exactly.
It's a cultural process of attributing life to inanimate objects of the nature.
Yeah. Actually, anima. Anima is a Latin word which means spirit. Or soul, or breathe, life, that is the etymological meaning. Anima is a Latin word, anima. It is from that anima, the word animism comes. Anima means life, breathe, or soul. That can be the meaning of anima. So, we attribute any animate or inanimate object, whatever object, maybe a tree, maybe a rock, maybe anything, a house built, whatever it is attributed, means people believe that there is spirit. It is a spirit. It has life. It has a soul. That kind of belief is understood as animism. And it was Edward Bernard Tyler. I referred to his name in the last semester, Edward Bernard Tyler. He was the one who defined it. A theory of universal animation of nature. A universal animation of nature. Earlier there was a sense of doctrine that animal life is produced by an immaterial soul. That was another understanding. And that comes from the German word animismus. Animismus. It was coined by a physicist, Georg Ernest Stahl. So, there was a sense of animal life is produced by immaterial soul. That sense was there. It was based on the concept of anima mundi. Anima mundi means the soul is, according to several systems of thought, is an intrinsic connection between all living things on the planet. That is the concept of anima mundi. The world soul means there is a concept of world soul. The world soul, according to many systems of thought, it is an intrinsic connection between all living things. So there is an intrinsic connection between the soul of humans, soul of animals, soul of plants. So that connection, it relates the world the same way as the soul is connected to human body. So that kind of concept is known as anima mundi. And from that concept, the German physicist Georg Ernst Stahl coins the word animismus. And this created a sense of doctrine, or there was a doctrine that animal life is produced by an immaterial soul. But today we understand it as a theory which attributes anima to any animate or inanimate object. So it's a belief that all objects, whether animate or inanimate, possesses vitality, or they are endowed with indwelling soul or spirit. That is the way that concept is understood today. Whether it is animate or inanimate, it possesses vitality, or it is endowed with a soul that indwells it, or a spirit that is dwelling in that object. Thus, all animals, men, earth, water, vegetation, mineral, anything and everything are invested with souls. That is animism. It is easy for us to theorize like this, but the people who believe it, how do they believe? What is the nature of their belief? You know, the soul is immaterial. So, it has its own thought and will. And this belief of the African people is carried over to the African attitude towards culture. In the masks they make, in the statues they make, this belief is carried over. Both the creation of a piece of a sculpture and its use in tribal rituals are based on animism. So, a statue is not simply a statue. It is not a representative of something else. It is actually powerful because it is a spirit. It has that anima. A vital life force is there. So, the power of a statue or a mask is believed to be more real than that of a living being. Okay, well, means for the believers or for the people of Africa, the indigenous people, they considered a statue made in a particular way following certain rituals, it has the power or it is more powerful than a living being. So they considered the statue itself as a spirit, something that has life, very vital, that possesses a soul. So this is their understanding. So those who possess this culture, and if an African, an indigenous man, he possesses a sculpture, he feels that he can depend on its power. It protects them. He believed that it will protect him, and also it promotes their welfare. If I am the owner of a statue, they believe that it is spirit, and they believed it protects them, and also it promoted to their welfare. Maybe we have statues being made in different religions. In Christianity we have different statues. In Hinduism we see so many sculptures in the temple. But very often they represent an idea. Especially in Christianity, it never believes that that statue has some power. Maybe a crucifix or the statue of Mother Mary, Madonna and the Child, there are so many. None of those images are considered as having certain power. Or nobody believes that there is a soul. No Christians believe that there is a soul that is indwelling in that statue. It is just a reminder, or it symbolizes divine grace. It's only a symbol, not the real. But for the African, an African sculpture is a spirit itself. It is not simply a symbol or representative of some other truth. It is truth itself. That is the difference. Maybe that is a concept alien to the rational or the civilized mind. Maybe we are not able to understand that. But the Africans believed. Africans believed that it has life. It has a soul and it is very powerful. Maybe powerful more than the living beings. And that attitude is transferred into the process of making sculpture and also in the use of that sculpture. And in order to understand and to feel the pulse of African art, we need to grasp this idea of the African mind. We need to grasp the idea of the African mind in order to understand the force that the African art radiates. So animism also consists in the belief in innumerable spiritual beings concerned with human affairs, and they are also capable of helping or harming human interests. So there are innumerable spiritual beings, and they are not idle. They always intervene with the human affairs. They are capable of harming or even helping the human interests or human affairs. And it was Sir Edward Bernard Taylor who made a survey. Who did a survey of these animistic beliefs. He surveyed the animistic beliefs. So it is from his time onwards this term is in currency, animism. The term became very frequently used in anthropological studies since the time of Edward Bernard Taylor. And I referred to him and his works in the previous semester. One of his books, Primitive Culture, which was published in 1871. You find a survey of animistic beliefs of indigenous people. So if you look at the major world religions, you may not find animism as it is, but there can be elements of animistic beliefs it contains. But most other religions, apart from the major religions, in most other religions we find the elements of animistic beliefs, especially with the religions of the indigenous people in different parts of the world. So when we understand the concept of animism, it also helps us to understand the nature of religions or the origin of religions. So that is the reason why it is very important. Okay, in order to understand the nature and origin of religions, the understanding of the concept of animism help us. And it is not a single trait. Means the when you say animism, it is not a single trait, but a view that the world is consistent with a certain range of religious beliefs and practices, many of which may survive in more complex and hierarchical regimes. So it is not a single creed. It's a range of religious beliefs and practices which we consider when we say the term animism. And some of it is also evident or seen in more complex and hierarchical religions. So the scholarship on these kind of animistic beliefs, it begins along with the age of exploration. So in the age of exploration, what you see is so much information comes from the newly discovered lands and people. So from the people of America, Africa, Asia, Oceania. So much information comes to the European scholarship, and especially from the Christian missionaries. So very often the Christian missionaries are considered like very unsympathetic towards the primitive or the animistic and other kind of beliefs. They are regarded as some kind of primitive superstitions. Very often the Christian missionaries considered the practices or beliefs of indigenous people of different continents as primitive superstitions. But some missionaries, they developed a scholarly interest in the beliefs that seemed to represent an early type of religious creed inferior to inferior but ancestral to their own. Maybe it's inferior to their own religious beliefs, but they found there is a connection. It can be an ancestral kind of creed which our ancestors also believed in. Generally, the Christian missionaries were very unsympathetic towards the beliefs and systems of or practices of the indigenous people they found in different parts of the world. But some of them developed a scholarly interest in the belief systems of these indigenous people. They somehow understood that it actually represents a type of religious creed, an early type of religious creed, which may be inferior to theirs, but also it can be ancestral to theirs. So in order to understand our own religion, if we study the religious practices and beliefs of these people, it will help us to understand our own religion. With that interest, many of the Christian missionaries started to scholarly explore their beliefs and practices. They started surveying them, they started analyzing them. So that's how the study begins. It is this interest that crystallized by Taylor in primitive culture. When you read Taylor, you find that kind of interest. The greater part of which is given over to the description of exotic religious behavior. So that was the initial interest of the Europeans in the animistic and related practices of the indigenous people. So when I was trying to find some material for this, I came across certain images. I will just share with you. I will show you a crucifix. Okay, this is a crucifix from Congo, circa 16th to 17th century, maybe after the in the age of exploration, because the missionaries were coming there. So I was just curious. I am showing this because I was just curious for maybe the style, when you look at the African style, is evident there. Though they are trying to represent the crucified Christ, the language of the indigenous people of Africa is very evident there. But I was thinking, for a Christian missionary who asked them to make it, for them it represents Christ, or the grace of Christ is being represented there, or it is a memory of the crucifixion of Christ. But how would a indigenous mind would look at this? There are also other sculptures like this. And I don't even understand who are the people seated on the four ends of the cross. So how they represented it, and how the African people understood it, and just curious, just out of that curiosity, I put those images here. It's a more detailed one. It's again from the Democratic Republic of Congo, 16th, 17th century. It's another one. Okay, means the way the Europeans looked at this and the way the Africans looked at this, they may be quite different. That is the point I wanted to make. And that is the point, concept of animism.